Hello and welcome to Open Line. I'm Starlene Stringer. August 18th is the big day. The DART Orange Line opens a 5-mile extension that will take travelers to DFW International Airport. Viewers were invited to submit questions through email. Our guests are DART Media Relations Director Morgan Lyons and Irving's DART Board Rep Rick Stouffer. Thank you both for being here.
Our pleasure.
Well, this is exciting. We've been talking about this for, it seems like forever, Morgan.
It's been a while.
And it's finally here. Tell us what you're most excited about.
I think just the opportunity to connect the nation, the world's third largest airport with rail service. And this puts us really on a level with London, with Paris, with all the great cities, all the great global cities, to have a one-seat ride from DFW International to downtown. And of course, the first stops are in Irving.
Love it, love it. And Rick, same question for you. What are you most excited about?
Well, the opportunity to see something completed. It's always exciting to be involved with a project that starts and you spend years looking at how where the alignment's going to be and the purchase of the land and then the procurement of the real estate as well as the equipment. Mm-hmm. And then actually seeing it done in phases, but now we've completed to the airport. So it's really kind of fun to see it completed.
I bet it's got to feel good for you guys. Well, let me tell you this or ask you this. I'm just going to let you know I'm going to ask some questions that people are probably wanting answered right now. And so one of the questions is, hey, this is going to Terminal A, but I might be flying out of a different terminal. So what do they do then, Morgan?
It's really easy. If, let's say you've got luggage and you're on American Airlines, which is about 85% of the traffic at DFW Airport, you just go to Terminal A, you go ahead and check in as you would at any terminal, you go through security, you hop on Skylink, and you're just fine. But let's say that you go to the airport and you are not flying on American Airlines. Again, a couple of options. If you don't have luggage, just go through security and get on Skylink. If you do have luggage, the airport has a bus service called Terminal Link, and it's just outside of Terminal A, just steps away, and all you do is get on that, and that serves each one of the terminals. So we make it as easy as possible for you to get around.
Well, you can definitely tell you guys are prepared for this. You've planned about everything and thought about everything,
right,
which is good.
Mm-hmm.
But what's left to do? I'm sure there's still some things that you've just got to complete before it opens.
You know, there are a few punch list items, as we say in the construction business, just a few things to kind of clean up. We've been on test trains. We were, you know, pleased to have Mr. Stouffer and have some folks from ICTN out on a test ride recently just to try to see what that's like.
Mm-hmm.
So we have some more testing to do. We also have some operator training to do. And then a couple of weeks before we open, we actually begin simulated service. And we operate a simulated schedule. So we not only get used to operating that, but people along the rail corridor get used to seeing the trains. And particularly folks in and around Terminal A get used to seeing those trains. And it's really a familiarization and a safety training component. And it's just one last thing to make sure everything's ready to go on the 18th.
It's going to be very exciting. And Rick, I know you mentioned earlier this is exciting for you because you've been working on this project for a while now. And to see it actually completed is wonderful. And I know, too, that you've seen it in different ways. So first as part of the city council, and then now part is the DART board. So why can you tell me why the city of Irving felt it was so important to be a part of this and to have the Orange Line?
Well, what we see for the Orange Line for the city of Irving is the opportunity for development along the right-of-way of the Orange Line, as well as a way for our businesses to have transportation for their employees.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I say this all the time, but a lot of people don't realize that the city of Irving has a population of around 220,000, and we have 225,000 people that come into our city every day and work. And this gives them an opportunity to have a schedule that they can meet. They don't have to worry about a traffic accident. They don't have to worry about something going on in the roads. They know what the schedule is. They can leave their home at an appropriate time and get to work on time and also be home in time in the evening to spend time with their family. So it's a real opportunity for the employment base in our city as well as the area. And those employees come from all over the Metroplex. So this in connection with the Blue Line and the Red Line and everything else really gives an opportunity for our employers to have a good opportunity for their employees to utilize it.
Sounds wonderful. And I know a lot of people listening right now and watching right now are saying, okay, this is great. I'm excited about this, but where do I catch the Orange Line? And they may not have seen our previous interviews with you, Morgan. So where can people take advantage of this and ride the Orange Line?
Well, the Orange Line's one of our longer lines. It actually goes all the way up to Plano. But through here, let's kind of work from the airport back. You've got the station at Terminal A,
okay,
Beltline Station, and then Northlake College Station, and then Irving Convention Center, Las Colinas, University of Dallas, and then Bachman Station, where you can pick up the Green Line in Dallas. So then it goes all the way on into downtown and then through downtown. So a lot of ways for folks in Irving to hop on the line and get to the airport. You know, one of the things that's great, Rick was talking about the jobs in the area, you know, there are about 60,000 jobs in and around the airport. So it's a great opportunity not only for folks who are looking for work in and around the airport, but it also opens a whole new labor market for employers at the airport. Again, you're able to tap into a workforce that doesn't have to worry about a car to get to work consistently, regardless of the weather.
Light bulbs just went off in business owners' heads. They went, yeah, that's true. That's good.
Right.
Tell us again one more time, those locations in Irving in particular where people can catch the Orange Line.
Beltline, Northlake College, Irving Convention Center, mm-hmm. Las Colinas, University of Dallas. Okay. Did I miss any? Good.
Got them all.
I had to get a tent just in case I was going to get it.
Got backup there.
Yeah, I was going to get a kick under the table if I missed one.
And the next question people are going to want answered is, when does it run? How often?
Well, 7 days a week. In fact, we're actually adding service because we're going to run earlier in the morning. We know there are a group of workers at the airport who need to get there really early. And so I think the first train pulls in about 10 minutes of 4 in the morning.
Wow.
And the last train leaves just after 1 in the morning. And so it's basically about an hour earlier and about an hour later than we have run before. So if you've got that early flight somewhere and you've got to get there a couple of hours early, we can take care of that. And for folks, a lot of people, you know, make one-day trips now.
Sure.
And so if you got to catch that early flight, you'll be able to do that. Or if you come in late, come right there and we'll be able to get you home.
Awesome. And it sounds like you've given us all these different locations. It's very convenient for people all across Irving. But if someone's sitting at home right now trying to plan, like, which stop is best for me? Where should I get on? There's other resources that can help them decide,
absolutely,
right?
Sure. If you just go to dart.org, okay, use the trip planning tool, and that'll tell you exactly how to plan your trip. We've got information on the website, on the schedules page, that'll show you the locations, gives you the map locations, mm-hmm, how to get to those particular stations. The bus, and most important, the bus connections. Because what we want to be able for you to do is to hop on a bus close to your house and take the bus to the train and the train to the airport. Just leave the car at home.
I like it. Makes sense. Now, Rick, as a person who's been involved in transportation for years, kind of tell us what you had to go through to get to this. What was the journey like?
Well, I think that it was something that we looked at as a city and as a region, because we knew that the traffic congestion was getting worse. We knew that the air attainment, that we were on the edge of not being able to receive some of our federal funds because of the air attainment. So we worked very closely with DART to have the alignment come through the city of Irving. It also gives us the opportunity to bring our students in. As he mentioned, we have two stops at universities, and so it's the opportunity to have them educated as well and have a cheaper form of transportation and a reliable form of transportation. It was interesting because we had to work with all the landowners. It was a real challenge because DART had the opportunity to get to the airport without any challenges. They had rail access and things of that nature. When we started this project, we needed to get all the landowners along the proposed line together and get them to agree to what they would develop and how far their setbacks would be and what their cost of land would be and how we would work together to assemble the land so that we could get where we were going. And of course, there along the way, there was challenges with, do we want to really go through this piece of land or do we want to go around this piece of land? And does this person really want it in their neighborhood or not? And so setting the track location was an issue. Also, we had to prove up the numbers. So we hired a consulting firm to come in with the proposed ridership numbers that would be achieved if we went through the alignment that we chose. And then as we move forward with that, we had the challenges of the neighborhoods we were going through, just like the rest of the Metroplex. And so when we came through the urban center, there's a difference. There's embedded track instead of the rails that are exposed. There's also brick pavers along the way. There's also the fencing is not stainless steel, it's wrought iron. The areas around the equipment is 2 foot higher than in other areas. So I mean, there was a lot of details, and DART was great to work with in making those things happen. Because when we went through the urban center, we wanted it to be very attractive.
Right.
And not that we didn't want it in the other areas as well, but it's more of a pedestrian area, and we wanted it to be fit well together. So there were those issues of dealing with that. And then of course, when we started the project several years ago, there was a cost. And then as we actually came to the time of actually doing it, you know, with inflation and things of that nature, and change in ownership of businesses, we had to work through those challenges as well.
Yeah, and we were taking a look at the video while you were speaking and talking about that area. You guys did a great job. It looks really, really nice. And I'm glad you gave us that background on it, because a lot of planning, a lot of thought, a lot of effort went into it. It's not just, we want to have the DART Orange Line, and here it is, and it's done. It took a lot of work to get it done. Something else you mentioned, Rick, you were talking about students and the universities that will really benefit from this, and you were saying how it's good for them to be able to get transportation and not have to pay so much, and some of them didn't have transportation at all, possibly. So it's very important that we talk about the cost for DART Orange Line, and also how you go about getting tickets. So can you answer those questions for us, Morgan?
Absolutely. It's really simple. It's $2.50. It's a one-way local fare, $5 for a day pass. It gives you access not only to this portion of the Orange Line, but really all of the DART system. So you just pick up your tickets. You can buy your ticket at the ticket vending machine, or you can do what a growing number of folks do, and that's buy it on your smartphone using the GoPass mobile ticketing app, which works on your Android phone or your iPhone. And you could buy your ticket ahead of time, so when you make your reservations, you can buy a ticket up to 60 days ahead of time and buy it, and then you just activate that ticket before you hop on the train or bus to get to the airport.
So simple. And when you get that ticket, is it something you're saying using your phone so it doesn't actually print out, or do you print it from your phone, or can you just show them your phone, or how does it work?
You just show them your phone.
Wow.
It's really simple. Yeah, it just generates an image, and you're just able to show them the phone, and they will see either a barcode, sometimes they have the readers, or they just actually see an image of a ticket, and it's just literally a what's called a flash pass, where somebody's just able to see that. And it's really convenient. We've got over 170,000 downloads since we launched that back in September of last year. So it's really just the way to go. And then for business travelers who have to come up with a receipt, they can go online and they can print out a receipt. So we try to make it as easy as possible for folks to get around.
Very convenient. And Rick, you didn't need a ticket, of course, on your preview ride that you took recently, but some people aren't familiar with the process and with riding rails. So can you just describe to us what it felt like or what it was like for you?
Well, I think it's interesting for me because you get a whole different perspective of the Metroplex. Wherever you ride on the train, you get a different view. You see things that you don't see on the roads, and you see the backs of businesses, you see the people's, how things are established in their yards and things of that nature. So it's kind of interesting to me just to see what all we have and the diversity of buildings that we have. You know, we have some unbelievably architecture, exciting buildings that people don't realize, and because when you're driving, you don't have the opportunity to actually see what you're doing. Where, I mean, you're paying attention to the road and what's on there. You're not looking, hopefully you're not looking at the buildings and the neighborhoods and things like that. So it's fun for, what I think, it's fun for me is to see how things are established. Coming onto the airport was, you know, most people don't get a real understanding of the airport and all the buildings that are associated with that and the different areas within the airport and how much land there is. It's a massive amount of land that's in that area. So I enjoy that part of it, but I think also people who are going to and from work, I know my wife uses rail whenever possible, wherever she's at, and it gives her the opportunity to work. And so it's that last 10, 15 minutes you need to finish something up, you can do while you're there in the comfort of the car.
And the students, you mentioned students, it'd be perfect for them to get those
last minute things done.
Yeah, get their last minute papers completed, yeah.
But it really gives you a whole different perspective of the Metroplex and the city and all that we have to offer, because you get an opportunity to actually visualize and spend the time looking at it.
Wonderful. And I know that you weren't alone on that ride. You didn't just take the train by yourself. So I know that people also were using the light rail that were media representatives, and mm-hmm. they got to go on it. What is the message you're wanting to get across about the rail by having them take this ride?
Well, we want folks to get a chance to see what this looks like and really through the media have that experience. Some of the video you've been showing really gives the different perspective. People are used to coming in very specific ways, and they've done that for the last 40 years mm-hmm. at DFW Airport. You come in from the north on 114 or from the south on 183, and this is a different approach, and you see a different part of the airport. The other thing we wanted to do was just reinforce that this is happening. We have talked about this for a long time. Service to the airport has always been a priority for DART. We've served DFW from the beginning with bus service because we knew that was important. But getting to the airport with rail, always a priority. So we really wanted to let folks know that this is happening, that it is easy, and that it is happening ahead of schedule and under budget. Mm-hmm. So all of those things. And then again, just how simple it is to just be able to get on and be dropped off just steps away from the terminal.
It is good you point that out, because it can be overwhelming for people who are not familiar with it, who've never done it before, like me. Or it could be that people are not using DART bus service, mm-hmm. but now you have a whole new audience that may say, I don't ride the bus usually, but I definitely want to take advantage of the Orange Rail. Are you expecting to have a lot of customers like that?
Sure. You know, we think one of the biggest opportunities for us is going to be the employee base.
Okay.
Folks who work there. Part of it is just that it is. I get on at the station, I get off at another station. Mm-hmm. I don't have to think about which corner do I get on, what's the bus number, anything like that. We make things as easy as possible in the bus service, and Irving's got amazing bus service. Went past, you know, a number of the routes that connect the TRE and then connect on the Orange Line as well. But having that rail service and being able just to get on here and know that you're going directly to the terminal, that gives folks a lot of comfort because it's just convenient.
Definitely. And speaking of convenience, let's talk about the parking. Mm-hmm. Say you're going on a week-long vacation. What are the rules for parking at a DART terminal?
We've been asked that question a few times.
I bet.
Yeah. So the parking is free.
Okay.
Now, what we will also tell you is that you park at your own risk. So unlike other parking lots, there's no, you know, we have police that come in and around, but they're there to monitor activity around the station. So you're parking there, and we want you to do that. But again, what we think is the best approach mm-hmm. is to work with us and find a connection to the train station.
Okay.
And you can get, there's so much good bus service in and around the area that serves the different stations. Any of the 500 routes are going to serve TRE or the DART rail stations. That's really probably the best way, we think, because that way you can leave your car at home.
There you go. And let me ask you this, are there going to be any service changes that come along with the opening for those that are familiar with DART services right now? Will there be changes?
Sure. We always, anytime we add some new rail service, we take an opportunity to make some adjustments. So there'll be some schedule adjustments. That information will be published a couple of weeks before the start of service. In our usual method, there'll be a service change brochure. We'll have updated timetables on the affected routes. Not every route will change, and we will make some adjustments probably to some routes and schedules that really aren't even connected to the airport. We just try to do all of those things at one time. So a couple of times a year, we're going to make service adjustments, but when we're able to, we try to coordinate it with a big event like this.
Okay, and what about bus shelters? Will there be changes to those as well?
Not immediately.
Okay.
You know, we're continuing to work on a bus shelter program to improve shelters and make them more accommodating and add a few of them throughout the service area. You know, we cover 700 square miles in 13 cities. There's about 13,000 bus stops.
Wow.
and then a number of those stops have benches or shelters. And we're always looking at ways to improve all of those.
Wonderful. And now back to you, Rick. We introduced you as Irving's dartboard rep. I'm just curious to know, so what does that entail for you? What is it like? What do you have to do?
Well, it's the dartboard is similar to the city council. It's similar to the DFW Airport Board in that they have a certain number of employees that operate all the facilities, and we act as a board of directors to oversee the operations, the budgets, and the agendas, the future growth development. We'll be working on the 2030 plan and the 2020 plan, and we always are looking out so many years for future growth. We always look at budgets and how the revenue comes in, and based on that, as Morgan mentioned, the routes will be changed based on ridership and things of that nature. So we're very, it's very similar to what we dealt with on the city council, and mm-hmm. that you're basically representing your city's interests as well as your citizens. And but the difference is you're really like, it's kind of like single member districts, but you represent all the citizens within the DART district. So you'd make your decisions based on what's best for everybody, but you make sure also that the things that you need within your city. Morgan mentioned the bus shelters. We're in the process of a 3-year plan where we're upgrading and adding bus shelters to the whole system. And so Irving's, each time we have a meeting, we're briefed on how many new ones have been put in and how many have been refurbished within each of the areas that we represent. So there's the constant overseeing of what's on ground here in Irving. The DART mm-hmm. maintains and operates. Mm-hmm. If there's any problems, I hear from residents, and then I pass that on to the management, and we work through any of the challenges, or we receive a lot of compliments as well.
Well, good. And I know also that during a recent city council work session, I see a few weeks back, there was a question raised about the wish for a North Irving, South Irving rail connection. I'm reading here. Any chance of that happening?
Well, you always put things like that in the agenda for future development. We work on those opportunities all the time. Most recently, there was the opportunity as that BNSF line crosses through a flood district to replace a bridge and work with them to expand that so it could be double tracked, which means in the future as we move towards the north-south connection on the BNSF, mm-hmm. we've accomplished something pretty substantial, because redoing a bridge and making those things happen all costs money and takes time. So
sure.
it's step by step, okay. It's piece by piece, but it's on the agenda as something that we evaluate and look at all the time. And okay. as the opportunity comes up, we'll look at it.
Sounds good. And Morgan, in the meantime, for someone who lives in South Irving or mm-hmm. a resident of, say, Valley Ranch, how can they connect on Orange Line?
Well, we make it as easy as possible. The first thing we want you to do is either go to dart.org,
okay.
plug in your address, plug in the nearest rail station. Again, you can look at the map to see where that is, and that's going to give you detailed instructions on which bus to get on, when it's going to leave from the area nearest you, and how to get to the station. If you don't do the internet, like some members of my family,
some don't, right?
7 days a week, you can call 214-979-1111, and we'll plan a trip for you.
Oh, very nice. Convenience again, we love
Absolutely.
It.
Absolutely.
Okay, Morgan, obviously it's not only Irving mm-hmm. that DART's able to help with this. Give us some examples of where we can go in the Metroplex on light rail, not just Irving.
Well, you've got all of the region's major destinations. You've got a one-seat ride to downtown Dallas. So if you're going to something at the American Airlines Center, if you're going to something in the West End, any in the Arts District, if you want to go to the Bush Library. Again, I mentioned the Orange Line kind of starts going north, and it actually runs on some red line tracks going north, so the Bush Library at SMU. That's just really convenient.
Yeah.
Most of the regions, most of the Dallas-Fort Worth area major medical centers are connected by DART rail. So if you work at UT Southwestern Medical Center, Children's Medical Center, Parkland, it's a one-seat ride to those locations.
Awesome. And give us some time frames. Like, how long would it take to get from Irving, say, to
downtown
Dallas?
It's about 40 minutes, 40, okay. 45 minutes, kind of depending on where you're going.
Mm-hmm.
So we just make it a quick and easy ride, and it's an opportunity to get some work done. And for the students, it gives them a chance to get that last minute bit of power cramming in. before an exam.
And that's good that you bring that up, because those are the people you expect to most use this. You would say students, business people.
We see all kinds of folks using it. One of the things that's been kind of interesting to observe is that light rail's a little over 20 years old, mm-hmm. are coming up on 20 years old in this area, and you're really starting to get a new generation of riders. These are folks who have grown up around rail, folks with kind of white hair like me. I didn't grow up with that around here. And so these are kids who've grown up around it. They've gone to the zoo for special events, and it's just really become part of their life. This is another way to make using DART part of your day-to-day life, and we think that just makes it easier for people to use, and it just becomes part of the decision about how you get around, so you don't always have to go to the garage.
Got it. And Rick, another question for you before we go. I know people who work in the urban center, they have an added benefit. That would be the APT, or People Mover. Can you explain what that is and how to connect?
Well, actually, that was something that Mr. Carpenter envisioned when he was doing his master planning for the urban center. And it connects several of the major office buildings together. And it really has seen an unbelievable increase in ridership. In fact, I was with Jackie Knox this morning, and we were talking about they're seeing about 3,000 people a week that actually use it to go between the buildings. And at the urban center stop, you can take the elevator or you can walk the stairs a couple of flights and get on the People Mover. So we're seeing more and more people use that as they go to their jobs.
How wonderful.
I agree with Morgan. I think you have a whole different younger generation that enjoys and embraces this type of transportation. Mm-hmm. And I think you'll see more and more people do the same.
Awesome. And you mentioned earlier that people are getting to see sites they may not pay attention to quite as often as they will now once they're riding on the DART Orange Rail. And so I want to ask you, what is the value for the city of Irving having the light rail riders actually see things they've never seen before in Irving? There's a value to that.
Well, I think that a lot of people don't realize what all we have in Irving. And when you come from the urban center to the Beltline station and you go up over the road and you look down at the new convention center, for example, it's really an interesting building the way it's designed and laid out. And then you can kind of go across and you see Mr. Carpenter's ranch, and here was a gentleman that spent his whole life developing this area that we now have the opportunity to enjoy. And so people see that. They also see the campuses and what the University of Dallas and others have to offer. So I think it opens people's minds to there's something here for me.
Awesome.
Something I might want to look at.
Exactly. And we're just about out of time. But before we go, Morgan, I want to give you the opportunity to tell us what else we need to know about DART. What's going on with DART other than this? Because I know there's a lot.
Well, Rick mentioned a couple of things. We was talking about some of the long range plans that we're doing. So we're always planning the next thing. So look for meetings coming up on it over the next several months.
Uh-huh.
But the thing most immediate for folks to see here is new buses. We've been adding new buses. We'll continue to add some new buses through the end of this year.
Okay.
And then we'll begin adding some new buses to replace express buses. These are high technology vehicles running on compressed natural gas. They're even cleaner than the ones before. So lots of new technology, and buses are so important to us. They move the largest group of our customers. That's probably the next big thing for folks to keep looking for, because you may be on a new bus one day soon.
There you go. And for people who are saying, I missed it, I didn't get the information about the app, they can just go to
dart.org.
Dart.org. And the phone number you gave?
214-979-1111.
And you got to tell us once again, when is that big day?
I think it's August 18th. Did that sound about right to you? Yeah, August 18th. I think we'll just open that.
August 18th, coming very soon. Thank you both for all you do.
Thank you.
And we want to thank you for watching. I'm Starlene Stringer. Please be sure to join us on Thursday, August 14th, for our next edition of Open Line. Dallas County Commissioner Elba Garcia will be our guest. And if you have questions, you can email ictn@cityofirving.org. We'll get answers for you on the next edition of Open Line. See you then.